We're here today with Ernie Louitt, a retired police officer and author, and enjoying his retirement very busily, I might add, with the number of speaking engagements he has with the release of his book, entertaining a lot of us out there in the community with some of the stories of policing in Saskatoon and the fine community that we have and the improvements that have happened in leadership capacities in the police department and in the community as a whole. Ernie, thank you for joining us today and making time in your busy schedule in retirement.
Well, thanks for having me, Randy.
Yeah. A lot of people have read your book. I've read it twice myself. It's fascinating because a lot of it has to do with the city that we live in, and it sheds some light on a lot of things that happen behind the scenes in your role, and a lot of people can relate to. Tell us a bit about yourself and where you came from and how you came to be with the Saskatoon Police Service.
Well, I'm originally from Northern Ontario, a little place called Oba, and I challenge people to find it on the map because it's where the Algoma Central Railway and the CN cross. I went to high school in a place called Hearst. Originally went to one-room school up to grade 8, went to a place called Hearst for, through my high school. Wasn't the best experience. We had to get boarded out, so I ended up quitting school quite young and went to the railway. Worked on the railway for a couple of years and then joined the Army. I was 17 when I was walking by a recruiting center in North Bay and going to see a band, and I was with my best friend, and I said, well, let's go join the Army, and he, a couple explicitives, told me he'd see me at the bar, and I ended up in the Army. Military, for me, was a very formative place, absolutely shaped my character and the kind of leader I wanted to be. And the nice thing about the Army, as a Native person, is most of the stereotypes were gone. In fact, all the work in your favor. I didn't mind people calling me chief because that was everybody called, you know, if you're a Native guy, you're a chief, right? But all the stereotypes in the military were, you know, I was never hungry, I never got lost, I never got tired, I could shoot, you know, 1,000 meters away and hit it every time. And so when I came to Saskatoon, when I decided I was getting out of the Army and passed the military police, and I came to Saskatoon, I was kind of expecting the same reception. That I thought, well, policing is like the Army, and that's, you know, your background or your racial background wouldn't matter. But when I came to Saskatoon in 87, it was, you know, the whole province was starting to change. We'd been in a long economic slump. Jobs were an issue. There was still some issues of race. A lot of people were coming in from the north unprepared for the south or for the urban centers. So there was a lot of conflict between the police and between First Nations and then the community at large trying to absorb all of that. So it led me on a journey that for the next 27 years with the Saskatoon Police where, I got to come in when it wasn't the roughest, but it was a very rough time. Well, there was a lot of violence, a lot of drugs, a lot of poverty. There was bars on 20th Street that were notorious places. And this didn't seem like as an entity, the police were interested in shutting those down and getting rid of them, even though everybody knew what they were. And there was a lot of issues like that. There was Lysol that was being drank. There was solvents that kids were sniffing. There was Chinese cooking wine. And I talk a lot about those in the book because they were all very pivotal and defining moments for me on the improvement of how you were going to improve the quality of life of Saskatoon. Because it seemed like everybody knew what the quality of life issues were, but we're like in an inertia.
Focusing on them.
Yeah, it was an inertia, organizationally, the city, the police. And even some people in the community that were feeling that, you know, the old throw your hands up in the air thing, like we can't do anything about it. So I call them picking fights, but it wasn't really picking fights. I was picking issues and picking them one at a time and running into some official backlash with me because I was trying some things that nobody tried or that they thought were pointless to carry out or that they were resource heavy or, it wasn't a very encouraging atmosphere. But the guys, the younger guys, and the guys that got it and were more open-minded were very supportive, but they were happy to let me do it, right? Just because if you're going to fall through the ice, we'll let you fall through the ice, right? Once you're across the river, we'll follow you type thing. But that's the way it was working. I tackled a lot of not popular issues. It wasn't the big 22-kilo cocaine bust, or it wasn't the... the serial killer that I caught or anything like that. It was just little things that needed to be done every day, right? So And as I was going along, I would try to get people like into my camp for to see that if you tackle the little problems, the big problems kind of take care of themselves, right? So I went on like that for quite a few years. Finally, when I got promoted, you know, my big thing, now I had a platform where I could actually had 12 people that I could influence and get them to think like I was. So one of the NCOs in the Army told me when I got to the battle school, he says, train your replacement from the very day you meet him, right? And I never forgot that. And that was one of my things. I've always wanted to train my replacement. Like some of the young constables that worked for me, the other guys would tease them, like little Ernie. And I thought, that's what I'm looking for. That's what I want, right? I want guys to be able to identify people. I want them to know about them. I want them to have empathy. Like, yeah, they know they're going to jail when you arrest them, but you don't need to taunt them and say, yeah, this is where you're going to be. Because when I first started, I was like that, like all young cops, right? Give a guy a little bit of leeway, to get in a foot chase, tackle him, put the handcuffs on him, tell him he's going to jail. Well, he knew he was going to jail. Didn't have to tell him, right? So those guys, my first couple of years, I kind of lost those ones because they hated me. They hated me right up until I retired and probably still hate me now because I was vindictive, right? But once they learned not to do that anymore, then it just totally changed my whole dynamic of policing. And, you know, it's one of those kind of things where you talk about, I like this survivor analogy, you know, the outwit. Well, I wasn't outwitting anybody, but I was outlasting people. And that's, what, you know, people that had attitudes like the, and this is one of those ones, as a leader, I just shudder when I hear this. When people say, we've always done it this way. Shudder. Unless they qualify it and say, because we know this way works. But if they just say, we've always done it this way, we're not doing anything, we're not trying anything, then yeah, that organization's in trouble, right? So anyhow, I went through my career and leadership was a big thing with me. I wasn't an inspector or a deputy chief or anything like that. So, but one of the things I would tell people about leadership, you could be a leader anywhere, no matter what your rank is. Like, well, you know, to take a shift at Tim Hortons of all kids in entry-level jobs, where the one kid says, you know, something falls on the floor and he instantly cleans up, setting an example for the other guy, setting that work ethic, all those things like that. Yeah. So you could be a leader anywhere. That was the way I always
thought. In those different roles.
Different roles, yeah. You know, and it doesn't. You don't have to be a leader all the time. It's transient. It changes around all the time. But anyway, so, once I retired, a lot of things became a lot clearer to me that I didn't realize that, you know, because when you're in the fight, I call it in the fight. When you're, you know, you're in that fog of policing, and you're thinking, man, nobody cares, or only a couple people care. I didn't realize, of course, that there's so many organizations in Saskatoon, in Saskatchewan, that were trying to make those changes as well. Right, when you were a police officer, you know, everything is bang, 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 and a lot of organizational and institutional changes and changes of attitude take a long time. But like, you know, when you can tell a young guy, right, how come it hasn't changed, type thing. But as my career was winding down, and you know, in all these, and because 20th Street was a big part of my career, big part of my life, Riversdale, Pleasant Hill, Caswell, the downtown. And I started seeing all these changes. Like, I'll give you an example. I guess the first real notch was when the Baldwin closed. I didn't know what the story was behind it closing, but it closed.
That's the Baldwin Hotel on 20th and First Avenue.
Yeah, and then right after that, the Windsor closed.
Yep.
Right? I didn't know a whole lot about the circumstances why they closed. Maybe they went bankrupt or maybe just got tired, whatever the case was. But it was there was a tangible feeling of relief, two down. Right, and kept on going. And then when the Albany closed, and then finally when the Barrie closed, the improvement in the quality of life for someone like me had been mixed up like with all the crime that happened with those associated with those places was instantly evident. It was like almost like you know, when you're going through the woods and you're coming to a clearing. That's what it felt like when they were gone. So all those little improvements as it went along, you know, like. I hadn't noticed all the people wanting those kind of changes in this beautiful community of Saskatoon. Didn't know what the emphasis was, but all I knew is, you know, because I had my little battle, and also I looked behind me. Oh, there comes here comes a trucker. You know, I'm winning, or we're winning, I guess. So towards the end of my career, we had new problems pop up like methamphetamines, meth, gym, whatever they call it on the street. terrible drug. And when I was in street crime, we thought we had it, for the most part, taken care of it, because the guys I work with in that unit were just absolutely on top of it. And I was a spectator by this time, because they were getting all these dealers and all that stuff. So then we had that. And then, of course, cocaine, when it first came here, you know, we were much later than the States, but when it finally came north, it was a huge problem. And because drug dealers now tend to populate rental houses and poor neighborhoods, of course, Riversdale and Pleasant Hill seemed to get the majority of the drug houses. And so, but that all passes too. You know, to the point where towards the end of my career, I was having to look a lot harder to find my drug houses, my, you know, because it was also transient, and it was just it was a good feeling. If that makes any sense, it was a good feeling that it wasn't all in one area, and it, you know, and I'm sure the rest of the neighborhoods in Saskatoon would be more than happy to keep the crime in one area, but the spread I seen was that the crime was spreading out, and so that's the neighborhoods that for so long had suffered so much criminality, where actually you could see new houses, you could see new fences, you know what I mean? Like, it was just, things were getting done.
Improvements.
Yeah. And you know, like Napoleon says, physical or morale is the physical 3-to-1. And you could tell when you could see people out shopping and, you know, and going to little shops and places that their parents probably warned them about, oh, don't go down to this street or don't go down to this particular area. You talk to people now and there's no area, like one particular area that is absolutely dangerous and perilous anymore. You know, there's places, you know, where it's probably not a good idea to go, but they're a lot less than they used to be. Because that whole corridor, like I said, from Idlewild to Avenue H for the longest time, you know, off duty I went and went down.
Yeah, it was a little rough.
Yeah, it was, yeah.
And you allude to that in the book, and is there any news that you'd like to share with us about a second book that's coming up before we close off?
Yeah, I just finished my first draft of the second book. It's a lot of stuff I didn't get in the first one because I was a new writer. But, you know, I'll talk about street prostitution and my view of what its real cost is to the quality of life for people, including the people involved in prostitution. Talk about drugs and, you know, its effects. It's devastating. It's really devastating. And you know, our kids, our children get bombarded all the time with pro-legalization, deregulation, all these different camps. Well, I'll tell you what the damage I see from drug use. And, you know, at the end of it, the reader can say, well, he's full of it, or he can go, you know, yeah, I never thought about it that way before.
So we've got something that we can look forward to very shortly, I would hope.
Well, we're hoping like I said, I just sent the unedited manuscript to the publisher. We're probably looking at June, but I don't want to put any pressure on them now.
We won't hold you to it, but okay. We appreciate you coming and letting us know about that. Ernie Louitt, affectionately known as Indian Ernie on the streets, and thank you for your years of service and sharing that with us in the book, and I'm looking forward to a movie someday as well.
Yeah. Okay. Randy, thank you.
Thank you, Ernie. I appreciate that.
Thanks a lot.
We'll be right back.